Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
God, for the ministry of health.
Yeah,
blessing. You're probably wondering where Pastor is. They took Maxine into surgery this evening. In fact, she's probably in surgery right now. And so he's down with the family. And they're just going to do some exploratory and find out what's going on. So if you could just kind of join me and pray for her right now, I'd appreciate it. Father, we thank you and we praise you for Maxine. We thank you that she loves you and she knows you. And God, she's in good hands. And Father, we just thank you and praise you that as the surgeons put on their gloves, you put on their hands. And Father God, you work through their hands and you settle this, you heal her, you mend her, you cause this situation to be made right in her body in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you that you comfort the kids as they're down there. And Father, you just cause them to know that your presence is so real with them. And we thank you and we praise you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. I knew at 5 o'clock that I was going to minister. So it's good in season and out. Amen.
Amen.
You know, the Lord's been talking to me about so many things lately and just showing me what he's doing in the earth. And it's just given me great encouragement and great hope. And, you know, ever since the election, and it's not about a man, it's about a plan.
Yes.
You know, he showed me, even from the election, the shift that had come to this nation. And because this nation had rejected a certain direction in taking this nation, I believe this nation was on the precipice to going off the edge. And I believe that the prayers have been prayed, the prayers like the Azusa Now and appeal to heaven and just all the different prayer meetings. Pastor and I, not only we're not involved in prayer in just one stream, you know, the Dutch Sheets and the, you know, those prayers, but the Billy Grahams, you know, the Word of Faith, and we've tried to tap into these different prayer groups because they have something to say.
Right.
I know we've been going to Billy Grahams prayer assembly for almost 20 years now, and Pastor missed one. I haven't missed any, but I know every time we go, we hear the news before it happens. I remember being in one of the prayer meetings to where we begin to, the spirit of prayer just fell on us, and we begin to pray, and after it subsided, a gentleman that they trusted and knew who he was got up and said, you know, I speak that form of Arabic that he heard in tongues during the prayer time. One of the leaders, I think Lynn Hammond, he said, I know that tongue. It's a form of Farsi, you know, an Arabic type language. And he said, we need to pray. God is telling us there's going to be a bombing in one of the larger malls before Christmas. And I don't know if you remember that one year, it's been several years ago, they found a guy that had several bombs in his apartment, and he was headed to the mall, Great America Mall, to set them off. And they found him ahead of time. And so I'm telling you, in prayer, you can learn a lot of things in prayer. God will reveal things to you. He'll show you the strategy of the enemies in your life. You know, back in the Bible days, they had enemies, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the, you know, all the Ike brothers out there. Well, you know, in our modern time, we have modern enemies, and they're isms.
Yes.
We don't have the Ikes, we've got the isms.
Right.
Atheism, socialism, humanism, communism. You know, we've got enemies that are out there that are bent and driven by the devil, that are bent on destroying the body of Christ.
Right.
You know, the devil's tried to destroy the body of Christ, tried to destroy the church. He's tried to destroy the righteous line before Jesus was even born, and even after Jesus was born. And it wasn't until Jesus laid his life down that his life wasn't taken, it was given.
Yes.
And so God has always got a plan. He's got seasons, he's got times. He's got strategies, prayer strategies for us to pray in certain directions. And he will give you a word, and he'll give you a prayer assignment.
Yeah, that's right.
God will give you a prayer assignment. And that prayer assignment, you need to stay with that prayer assignment until you know there's a release. Yeah. You'll sense a release.
Yeah.
The desire, or the drive, or whatever you want to call it, just will lift. And you'll know that you've prayed what you need to pray. I remember several years ago, he had me do a prayer school here at the church on Tuesday mornings. And I probably did that for 5 years. Every Tuesday morning, we teach on prayer, and then we would pray. And there was a lot, you were in some of those, I know. There was a lot of things done in that prayer service that I'm seeing coming to pass now.
Yeah.
I'm seeing those things come to pass. The things we prayed about, and the things that God made issue in the spirit concerning that. And after that end of 5 years, it was over. I knew it was over. People say, why did you quit the prayer school? Because it was over. That season. God will give you seasons that he gets you on something. A lot of the things that you saw in this current election and the things that you're seeing, we prayed about, 10 years ago.
Right.
And God began to move it. And all these prayer meetings and things that are taking place, they're all saying the same thing. That the kingdom of God has got momentum. The kingdom of God has begun to take ground and begin to rise up. And see, it's so important that as a body, as a part of the body of Christ, over in Acts the 17th chapter, the 20th verse, it says, in him, speaking of Jesus, we live and move and we have our being. Now, see, that is all a part of the kingdom. Is in him we live. You live in Jesus. When you begin to live in Jesus, you begin to there's things that you just don't do anymore.
Right.
There's attitudes that you don't have anymore. You're in him, and it's a holy place.
Yeah.
You know, he wants you to have fun. You know, you don't go around. Somebody asked him, a minister that we know, asked him, God, what about ball games, And he says, well, I don't have any problem with ball games, just take me with you. And so, God doesn't care about us having fun, but in him we live. And every place we go, we take Jesus with us. And we change, like Pastor Mike was saying this morning, we change atmospheres with our presence. In him we live, in him we move. When we're in him and we're moving in him, we go where he tells us to go.
Yeah.
That's right.
We do what he tells us to do.
Amen.
We say what he tells us to say.
Right. Yes.
And there's times in your life that he will move upon you concerning prayer, and you'll see something. I'm just kind of dovetail into what Mike was preaching this morning. God will show you. If you'll spend time with him, he will show you things. He'll begin to show you this over here, that over there. God has me over in government a lot. I pray into government a lot. I go to the state capitol and I walk the state capitol.
Amen.
There's times that, because the Bible says every place that your feet shall tread, I'll give to you.
Amen.
And so I'll go and I'll walk the perimeter of the capitol there, and then I go inside. I like to go inside because they have a hallways that have got exhibits of all 58 counties in California.
Yeah.
And I like to go through there, and I just kind of run my hands along the along the rail there in front of every county and just pray and listen to what God has to say. And there's sometimes I'll stop, and he'll have me declare things into the counties there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I know where the all the meeting rooms are. I go down into the basement, and I move all around because I know that my presence there is bringing the presence of God there, and it'll do something. And there are fabulous Christian men and women that are in our government that are fighting as hard as they can fight, and they need our prayers.
Amen.
They need our support.
Amen.
I've told this before, Shannon Grove that's there. She's a strong Christian. And we were in an office one day, and she leaned over me and she says, "We're taking this office." she's just a powerful woman of God. And I pray for her frequently because she gets a lot of persecution for her stand in God. In fact, the first year she was there, they moved her office from the main floor to the basement as a punishment. And she says, "That's fine with me, I'll just shake this foundation." And so, you know, it's God will give you things that you pray about. You know, if you come on Wednesday night, we have the seven mountains, you know, the seven spheres of influence, you know, media, government, schools, family, you know, arts, you know, the different religion, the different mountains. And everybody that's here has a mountain or has a sphere of influence that God gives them in prayer. And if he gives you influence in those spheres, then he gives you authority in those on those spheres. And so here a while back, I said all that to say this. Here a while back, I was praying about the state of California, and I heard the Spirit of God say this: break the hold of the cults in California. And boy, I got excited. I thought, "Ooh, I get to kick some." You know what? And I like that kind of prayer. I'm praying. I don't know about you, but I like a good fight in the spirit. You know? And I was all ready to do that. And then, so I said, "Okay, God, give me some scriptures. You know, how do you want me to pray about this? How do you want me to, you know, how do you want to break the hold of the cults and the isms that are in this state?" And he started giving me these scriptures about praying for the church. And I'm going, he says, "You've got to understand." He said, "It's been years since the church is in the position they're in right now." Amen. And the church is in the position right now, what we see in the book of Acts. Where it's like we're the infant church almost. Because the church has not grown in the kingdom the way that they needed to grow. They haven't kept pace with what God is wanting the church to do. And he says, it's time that the church picks up pace, picks up the pace. And he says, where you've walked before, he said, where you've crawled before, you're going to walk. And where you walked, you're going to run.
Yes.
And where you run, you're going to fly.
Yes.
And so he began to show me there's an acceleration in the kingdom of God to get some things done before Jesus comes back.
That's
now, do I know when Jesus is coming back? Yeah, when he comes back. You know, I don't know. You know, it could be 2 months from now, or it could be 20 years. I don't know. I'm just kind of like John, the Apostle John, come quickly, Lord Jesus. But yet on the other hand, the part of me is saying, this is going to be the wildest ride we have ever seen. I mean, I can't even wrap my brain around some of the things that God shows me that he wants to take place in the body of Christ. And we've got momentum now, and God wants us to keep momentum. So turn over with me to Colossians 4. We're going to stay in the book of Colossians, I think, because those are the scriptures he gave me. And we're going to kind of start at the last chapter and work toward the front chapter. I'm just going to give it to you the way he gave it to me.
Praise God.
Colossians 4. Now, he's closing up the book here. And I thought that was kind of unusual that he started me at the end. But he's talking about Epaphras, or however you say his name, in verse 12. He says, "Who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you." And then he says this: "Always laboring fervently for you in prayers." So here's this disciple that Paul says he's always fervently labors for you in prayer. And this is what he prayed: "That you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God." So the Spirit of the Lord said, he said, pray this. And so I begin to pray this. God, I thank you that the church is perfect and complete in all the will of God.
Yeah.
And as I begin to pray that, the Lord began to show me that word complete means, it actually means fully assured.
Amen.
The church needs to be fully assured that if God be for them, who can be against them?
Yeah.
That whom shall we fear? You know, God is with us. Whom shall we fear? There is no fear. There is no bad news. There's no bad report.
Right.
There's nothing out there that God isn't well aware of and knows how to get you through it and out of it.
Amen.
And so no matter what circumstance you're in right now, you need to be firm. Stand firm. See, and that's what I started praying for the church, that they stand firm in all the will of God, mature and fully assured.
Amen.
So this is the area, not only for ourselves do we need to pray this, but we need to pray for the church. Because as the church grows in influence, as the church grows in power,
right,
and that power comes out of that assurance,
yes,
that whatever God shows me, whatever he tells me to do, he's going to give me the authority and the power to demonstrate and manifest his will in that situation.
Amen.
So when he tells you to speak in a situation, you need to be complete. You need to be fully assured that what you're saying into that situation by the Spirit of God, God is going to take care of it. Amen? And let's turn to Colossians 3. And he instructed me again. He said, pray for the church in Colossians 3. Verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another, if anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you. So he began to have me begin to pray into the body of Christ a spirit of forgiveness. See, because when you truly forgive someone, all of these other things operate. There's tender mercies, there's kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, and you're bearing that person. You're bearing up or bearing that person. And so God says there needs to be a forgiveness, a spirit of forgiveness that comes into the church, and how they're going to do it as you pray into the church, tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. So that the spirit of forgiveness in the church. You know, I can't tell you how many people that I have watched over all my years of being in the church, and I mean, I was born on a Sunday, and I was in church the next Sunday. And so I've been, you know, around church all of my life.
Yeah.
And I can't tell you how many people stopped going to church because they got in unforgiveness.
Sure.
They got offended.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody hurt my feelings.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody didn't treat me right. But there's something about learning, you know, Pastor Mike preaches on it quite frequently, and I try preaching it, you know, whenever the Lord lets me, about the love of God, how important the love of God is, and how it needs to be activated in the body of Christ. When we realize how much Jesus really did do for us, out of his love for us, how dare we hold anything against anybody? When we murdered Jesus, and now just putting it kind of plain, our sins hung him on that cross. Our sins killed him. Yet he said from the cross in the middle of all his pain, forgive them for they don't know what they're doing.
Right.
And so we need to have that, you know, we need to put that on. Put that same spirit on us concerning people. I don't know how your day went. You know, I used to tell that to the boys, you know, that, man, our teacher was mean today. Da, da, da. And I'd say, but you don't know what she went through at home before she got to work. You don't know what she has to go home to when she goes home. And we tried to make that a point of prayer and a point of discussion in our home. Because I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're going to have to go home to.
Right.
I don't know what you're facing tomorrow at work or at school or wherever. And so a lot of times when people say things, they don't like I said this morning, they don't wake up in the morning and say, I think I'm just going to tick Karen off today.
Right.
You know, it comes out of, their anger comes out as a secondary emotion. Their anger is a secondary emotion. Something else has happened to trigger that anger at you. And so we need to understand that people's intention isn't to be rude. You know, people, I mean, there may be some people out there, I'm sure, that are just cranky old people. They know they are and they don't care. I don't know.
Yeah.
But most people don't get up in the morning thinking about who they can hurt that day.
Right.
Unless they're really sick.
Right.
And so, you know, we need to be just as forgiving as Jesus was to people.
Amen.
You know, people come to me and, you know, complain about somebody, and my question is always this: well, you know, you need to just let them be who they are. Well, yeah, but no, because what you're telling me is something on the inside of you was triggered by their action. To get a reaction, something's got to be triggered.
Right.
Somebody had just flipped your gauge. You know, and you need to get with God and find out why that bothers you so bad.
Sure.
You know, when somebody makes me, you know, I'll use Pastor since he's not here. I use Pastor. You know, sometimes, you know, if he's upset about something and he says something to me that really hurts my feelings, I used to not take that sitting down. But, you know, God's been teaching me over the years, you go pray for him. You know, or ask him, what can I do to help you? I can see you're upset. I can see you're bothered about something. What can I do to help you? And I'll tell you, if you want to diffuse somebody's anger, just say, oh, I'm so sorry. I can see you're having a really bad day. What can I do to help you? Well, I'll tell you what, people just almost fall over themselves. They don't know how to handle kindness. They don't, you know what he says here. He says, put on tender mercy.
Yes.
Kindness, humility, meekness. Meekness is an interesting word because it says this: you've got the power to deal with that situation,
yes,
but you choose not to.
It's good.
For the good of the situation.
It's good, right.
That's meekness. Humility is realizing that you don't know everything,
right,
so I'm just going to back off and ask God what to do about this situation.
Yeah.
I had a lady call me on the phone one time and just really chew me out. She was very angry with me and chewed me out, and I'm going, where is this coming from? And so I let her talk, and I said, God, how do you want me to handle this? And he says, just let her talk. Just let her talk. And so it was really funny at the end. You know, she chewed me out, told me all the bad things that I had done to her. And then she says, I think you just need to pray now. And I go, whoa, buddy. I'm thinking, oh, Jesus, help me now. And so I did. I you know, I said, okay. I said, Father, I just ask you to bless, and I named this person. I said, I just ask you to bless them and minister to them today. And Father, I thank you. I just speak peace into her heart and her mind. And Father God, I just, if I did anything, or if I did these things that, you know, she said I did, please forgive me. And I asked her for forgiveness. And Father, I just thank you. And I just prayed a just nice little prayer and blessed her. And because she was, and come to find out, she was going through some really fearful medical things. And she was really upset over them. And whatever I did became the target of her upsetness, if that's a word. But, you know, we need to understand that people are going to be people. People have all kinds of issues. People in the body of Christ, yes, they're born again. They're probably spirit-filled. They're going to heaven. But we still have issues in life. We still have things to deal with that we don't have to deal with. We don't know how to deal with them. We're either afraid or frustrated or upset. And so being this type, it says put it on.
Put it on.
Put it on. It's something that probably in your natural flesh, know, you don't have it put on. And so Paul's saying here, put it on. You know, as elect of God, holy and beloved, put on. See, he's identifying you, not the other person. He's identifying you.
That's good.
And he says, you put on. You are the elect of God. You're holy and beloved. So put this on.
Yes.
And so I begin to pray for the church that we would learn to walk in these things, that we would learn to be forgiving one to another, that we would give people room to address their own issues and not just keep putting fuel on the fire. Those people have got the devil has honed a weapon against them. He set a fire in their life so he can build his weapon. And if we keep putting fuel on the fire, we're just giving the enemy more fire, more heat to hone his weapon against that person. And see, we need to understand that our prayers can quail or quench the fires of the enemy.
Yes.
That he's using.
Right.
He's probably using things people have said to them. He's using situations in their life. He's wearing them down. He's wearying them. He's frustrating them. And they've got enough fire going on, ungodly, unholy fire going on in their life, without us taking our words and causing that fire to be even greater, and that and enabling the enemy to build a weapon that can destroy that person. I don't know about you. I don't want to be responsible for somebody's life being destroyed.
Right.
Because I spoke against them instead of speaking to them.
That's good.
And speaking for them.
That's
in
good.
The spirit.
Yeah.
So the prayer for the church is, you know, God help us as holy, elect, and beloved to put on these things and learn to walk in them in the body of Christ.
Amen.
So that we can be Smokey the Bear. We can put out the fires before they destroy a person's life. I mean, Lord knows if somebody's down and out, there's enough people speaking against them. The devil is talking to them enough without us adding to it. So we need to have a tender heart. We need to be merciful and long-suffering and bear with that person by praying for that person. Turn with me to 2 Colossians.
2
Colossians? 2 chapter of Colossians.
Oh, I was like, I didn't know
I'm being dyslexic. I'm getting the two before the Colossians. Colossians 2, and let's look at verse 6. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding in it in thanksgiving. So we need to be the type of person that lives in thanksgiving.
Yep.
We need to be rooted and grounded in all that God has done for us, all that we've learned from him. Be rooted and grounded in that. By being rooted and grounded, you're getting your nutrition. You're getting all the nutrients. You're getting the water. You're getting everything you need to cause you to grow. And as you grow, you begin to be a blessing to people around you. And so he's saying there, therefore we've received Christ, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
The first day of March, the Lord spoke to me and he said, we're marching on in March. And when he said that, I heard that old song we used to sing. I hear the sound of the army of the Lord. I hear the sound of the army of the Lord. It's a sound of praise.
Yes.
It's a sound of war.
Yes.
The army of the Lord, the army of the Lord, the army of the Lord is marching on.
Yep.
And he began to tell me that March was a month of praise.
Amen.
That is, we praise God. And then Pastor ministered, I think, a little bit on that too. Because your praise, as you praise God, as you live in thanksgiving, you know, it's really hard to get upset with people when you're living in thanksgiving. It's real hard to get upset about circumstances in your life when you're living in thanksgiving.
Right.
Over in I quoted this morning over in Psalms 13. It says that my heart will rejoice in your salvation.
Yeah.
And there's something about rejoicing. There's something about the streams that God takes you in that causes you to be glad.
Right.
And when you begin to thank him about all that, I mean, you think about the word salvation, sozo, or salterio. Yeah, there's two different words. But you think about the word. It's not only you're going to go to heaven, you have eternal life. It means healing and health. It means prosperity and wealth. It means protection. It means deliverance.
Yes.
And when you think about all that Jesus did for you, all that you've been taught that Jesus has done for you, how can you not live in thanksgiving?
Right.
You know, there's something about thanking him. The other day I woke up, and I don't know about you, but it's like when I opened my eyes, the devil's sitting on the side of the bed and immediately begins to tell me how bad things are in my life. And haven't you waited long enough for such and such? Yeah, God's doing it for you. Right, yeah, I can see that. I don't know about you, but sometimes I wake up to that. Not all the time. But sometimes I wake up to that, and if I give into it one little bit, the depression, there the depression is. There the, oh, woe is me, you know. I'm just God's ugly stepchild. He doesn't, you know. And you just, you know, you get this real self-pity party going on in your life. And when the Lord began to talk to me at the 1st of March to do that, I put it to practice. When I get up in the morning and the devil's trying to tell me what the news is going to be for the day and it ain't good news, I just begin to worship and praise God. Father, I just want to thank you and praise you. I thank you for what Jesus did for me.
Yes.
I thank you that healing is mine. I thank you that deliverance is mine. Prosperity is mine. I thank you that I have eternal life. Hallelujah. And it's not in hell. Father, I just thank you. And then I just start giving the devil some of it. Yours is, buddy. Your destiny is hell. Your destiny is burning in the lake of fire. Your destiny is complete separation from God. Hallelujah, God, I thank you that you love me.
Yes.
I thank you that you saved me. I thank you that I have eternal life in heaven.
Yes.
I thank you, Father God. And I just begin to praise him. And as I do that, boy, the devil won't stay on the side of the bed long. He's up and out of there real fast. And so taking the time to understand what Jesus has done for you and begin to praise God in that and give thanksgiving for that. Praise God and give thanksgiving for the believer's church.
Yes.
You know, and as you praise God, I found out as I start praising God concerning the believer's church, I say, because that's the only church we pastor, so I begin to thank God and praise God for the believer's church. I thank you that you bless them. I thank you, Father, that their generosity is making a way for them into prosperity.
Yeah,
I thank you, Father God, that you're healing their bodies. I say that there's not one feeble one among us.
Yes.
God, that we have the silver, we have the gold, we have the jewels. Father God, and you've delivered us from this evil world.
Glory.
And as I begin to worship and praise God for this church and the people that are in this church, he starts bringing your faces before me. One by one by one. And I worship and praise God when I see your face.
And
I worship and praise God that he's moving. And I found that, boy, I just sometimes have just hallelujah parties. You know, pastor comes in to pour me another cup of coffee. He's such a good man. And he says, oh, excuse me. And I said, no, just join me. Thank you, Father. You know? Just begin to worship. And I tell you what, it changes your atmosphere. It'll change the atmosphere in our services. If we come in and don't wait for the worship and praise people to get us started, it's kind of like starting a motorcycle. And we just come in here with thanksgiving. We don't drag in here on fumes. Because we've been giving God thanksgiving all week long. And so we come in with thanksgiving, and Glenn's thanksgiving joins with Ron's thanksgiving, and you know, with Pat's and Bonner's, and you know, we just begin to have this praise party together. I say, you watch God do more things in an atmosphere of praise and worship, in an atmosphere of thanksgiving. It'll revolutionize your life.
Yes. Yeah.
You won't be able to wait for the next Sunday. We won't have
Amen.
If people begin to come in to a place that they begin to live in thanksgiving. And so that's been my prayer for the church. God, teach us to live in thanksgiving. Live in what we've been taught. Help us to be rooted and grounded and built up in Him. Help us, Father God, to understand what Jesus has done for us and to worship and praise Him in that. It'll revolutionize your life.
Right.
I just challenge you to take the rest of the month of March. There's not a whole bunch left.
Mm-hmm.
But just wake up every morning before you ask for anything,
yes,
before you pray for anything or about anything. Just take time to worship God.
Yes.
On your way to work, just worship and praise God.
Yes.
Think of all the good things. I mean, the devil's there to remind you of all the bad things, but you just begin to think about all the good things. And every bad thing he says, you praise God for something good.
Right.
And he tells you something else bad, you praise God for something else that's good in your life. And I'll tell you what, it'll change not only your atmosphere, but it'll change your way of thinking.
Amen.
It'll change it.
Yeah.
So the prayer is that we clothe ourselves with compassion. I already did that one time. We're at two. We pray that we I can't read my own writing. That we continue, okay, I didn't cross my T. We continue to live for Jesus, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in faith, overflowing with thanksgiving.
Yes.
So I prayed for thanksgiving in the church. You know, and as I begin to pray these things, you know, God begins to show me that's how you're going to break the cults and the isms,
right,
in your state, is when the church begins to do these things. As you pray for them and the church begins to do these things, the church becomes such a powerful force in this state that the devil's plans are wiped out. He's hell-bent to destroy this state. And he's doing a pretty good job of it right now, folks. But if he can change a nation, he can change a state.
Yes.
And if he can change a state, he can change a county. And if he can change a county, he can change a city. And if he can change a city, he can change a people. I'll tell you what. Yeah, God is getting ready to do a major shift in this state. And you're getting ready to see some things that just amaze you. You know, you'll go, what? You won't believe what God is getting ready to do.
Lord.
Turn me to Colossians, the first chapter.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When I start thanking God, I get excited.
Enough.
God is good. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you.
Well, let's start with verse 9. Paul prayed, for this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will,
yes,
in all wisdom and spiritual understanding.
Yes.
So I pray for the church and I pray for myself that I be filled with the knowledge of His will,
yeah,
and all the wisdom and spiritual understanding.
Yeah.
God will give you wisdom and spiritual understanding. You know, I've been, He's told me a couple things to pray for this presidency now. He said, pray or speak over the president that he will have supernatural and divine wisdom.
Yes.
Supernatural and divine wisdom. And he said, over the plans, specifically this healthcare plan that they're working on, that it will, this is the word he told me to pray. Pray that it will be ingenious.
Hallelujah.
Ingenious, that other nations will use it as an example. So that's what I'm saying. When you ask God, what do you need me to pray about today? He'll begin to show you things. And He'll begin to give you words to pray exactly what He wants you to pray. And the words He gives you are full of power. And so every day, you know, at least one time a day, I say, Father, I thank you that this administration is full of supernatural and divine wisdom. And I thank you that the plans and the programs that they develop are ingenious.
Yes.
They become a pattern for the world.
That's good. Amen.
And so, you know, it's important that we pray what God says, because
yes,
it will change,
yes,
you know, it will change the atmosphere. That we be filled with knowledge of His will. See, that's His will, and that's His wisdom, and He'll give them spiritual understanding. that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being filled with every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, and strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy.
Yes.
Not patience and long-suffering complaining, but patience and long-suffering with joy.
Yes.
Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us. I love that. We don't qualify ourselves. He qualifies us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. And he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed or transferred us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. And you know, then it goes on. But those verses there are so important because we can take the Word of God. We can take the wisdom. See, you know, Mike's talking about operating in the gifts of, you know, the gifts of the Spirit, operating in the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and tongues and interpretation and prophecies, discerning of spirits, you know, the gift of faith, you know, the gifts of healings. See, we can operate in all of those gifts in our prayer time.
Absolutely.
He can give you words of knowledge and words of wisdom. Words of knowledge are past and present, concerning past and present. Words of wisdom are for the future. So when he gives you a word of wisdom, like he gave me, he said, I'm going to give this president supernatural and divine wisdom. And I'm going to cause his plans to be ingenious. Now again, it's not about a man, it's about a plan. And so whatever you think good or bad about Trump, it's not about a man, it's about God's plan. And God's got a plan, and he had to get somebody that's going to operate and flow with him. And a lot of I don't know if you're aware of it, but a lot of the people that he's surrounded himself with are Christians.
Yeah, absolutely.
Michael Pence is, I believe it's Michael Pence, our vice president, is born again, spirit filled.
Amen.
And he is a voice to President Trump. And you know, he's surrounded him with people that know how to speak into his life. So as we pray for this administration and we pray for these people, they will give him the right words, the wisdom, the knowledge of God that needs to be implemented in this nation.
Yes.
And so it's important that we continue to pray. I mean, the Bible says in 2 Timothy that we pray for, you know, all of our leaders.
Yeah.
You know, and that we might live peaceable. And, you know, the last few years hasn't been too peaceable in the church because there's been a lot of persecution, which, praise God, that persecution has driven the church to prayer.
Yeah.
I mean, it happens, you see in the book of Acts, when they persecuted them in the book of Acts, what did they do? They went in and prayed, they said, God, increase your power.
Yes.
They didn't ask God, oh, please protect me. No, they said, increase your power through us.
Amen.
And that's what we're starting to see in the body of Christ, that momentum in the kingdom of God. So he's saying here, it's important that we pray that the church walks worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy, giving thanks, there it is again, learning to live thankful, living with a thankful heart, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us.
Yes.
Boy, I tell you, there you go.
Yes.
God puts you in a position, you say, God, I'm not qualified. Don't worry about it, I can qualify you.
Hallelujah.
You know, he knows how. I can't tell you how many people that I know that God's given jobs that they didn't qualify for.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But God's put them right in those jobs and caused them to flourish in those jobs. God knows how to qualify
you.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. And then number five, that was number four. Number five, let's go back to Colossians, the fourth chapter.
Take him off.
Yes.
That verse 13 there where it says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness.
Uh-huh.
That word power in the Greek is authority.
Yes.
He's delivered us from the authority of darkness.
Darkness does no longer have power over you. Amen. You find yourself in a dark situation, you just command the light of God to shine in that situation. That's a whole other sermon. That's a whole other teaching that I've got. I mean, I got over to 1 Thessalonians somehow. Yes. Washington 1. Excuse me, 4. I'm sorry. Verse 15. It says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called. Not only does the peace of God rule in your heart, you've been called to peace.
Yes. Yes.
You've been called to peace.
Yes.
The Children's Church has a big sign that says, I am called in there. You know, you've been called to peace.
Yes.
God just didn't let you get born again. He called you to peace. Over in Philippians, he called you to victory.
Amen.
You know, he called you to operate in all of his power and all of his glory.
Yes.
And so it says here, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you were also called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching, admonishing one another, psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So we need to be praying into the church of God, praying them into their calling. Their calling is peace.
Yes.
You know, wherever fear is an absence of peace.
Yes.
When fear comes to you, it comes to you to steal your peace.
Right.
So wherever fear is, there's an absence of peace. And there's God has called you to peace. Jesus said this, he says, peace I give to you.
Amen.
He bequeathed it, he gave it to you, he left it to you.
Yes.
And he says, not the peace that the world gives. The peace the world gives is if everything's going good, you feel good.
Yeah. Yes.
Right.
But there's a peace in God that all hell could be busting out around you, and there's a peace that you can abide in.
Yes.
Where that doesn't affect you.
Thank
that's
you,
why
Lord.
Paul. That's Amen. Why Paul could tell Timothy. He told him. He said, "Don't. You know, you're a soldier, but be a good soldier. And a good soldier doesn't entangle themselves in the affairs of the world.
Right.
If you listen to the news 15 minutes, it's real easy to get entangled.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Oh, yeah.
But when you know what God has said about a nation. What God has said about your state, what God has said about your president or your senators, or when you know what God has said, I tell you what, I lived in such peace.
Yes.
Man, I was screaming at the TV for months. You know? Idiots, right? That's what I want to. I can't believe they're doing that. You know, and God had to say, you know, what are you fueling?
Right.
What are you throwing wood? What fire are you throwing wood on?
Right.
Exactly.
What fire are you throwing gasoline on?
Right.
You know, and that's why he said, pray for the church that they speak what I'm telling them to speak. You don't get entangled with the affairs of men. They're crazy.
Yes, they are.
And I'm not saying that to be mean. No, no. It's just that when you've got the devil running your life, and you're not following God in Jesus Christ, you are insane.
Yeah.
In fact, the Bible even calls them morons.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, they don't have a clue.
Right.
So they're going to do what they do. Sinners do what they're going to do.
Right.
And you can either get mad at them or you can pray for them.
Yeah.
Now, do I have righteous indignation? Yeah, I do. But the Bible says don't take that righteous indignation and turn it into a form of anger that you'll sin in.
Amen.
Right.
You know? And so, you know, Jesus was angry when he walked into the temple and saw what they were doing to the house of God. He was angry, but he didn't beat the people, you know. He beat what was driving them. He turned their tables over, you know, and you know, he didn't attack the people because they were just doing what they were influenced to do.
Right.
And so people that you see doing crazy things, they're just doing it because they're under an influence that is unholy and ungodly and insane.
Right.
They're out of their mind.
Right.
Yes.
And so they're being dictated by the lust of their flesh.
Yeah.
You know, they're being dictated by an insane entity called Satan,
right.
Called the devil.
Right.
And so So it's important that we hear what God is saying. We don't get entangled in the sin of the world. We pray what God tells us to pray. And so, you know, I'm wanting to encourage you to begin to see the Church of Jesus Christ worldwide. Begin to see it in the scriptures that I've given you tonight out of the book of Colossians. I mean, you can even read through the book of Colossians. It's a very instructional book as how to live and how to pray and you know, to live in the thanksgiving and live in the rejoicing and know that God, you know, I won't say God is in control. There's a certain element of that. God's in control of his plan.
Yeah.
He's not in control of the world because you're dealing with free wills of people. But God's very much in control of his plan.
Yes.
And he's working his plan right now. Mm-hmm. And we need to cooperate with it. We need to spend time, listen to what he's saying to them. If somebody frustrates you on TV, some politician or whatever, go to God and say, how do you want me to handle this? Mm-hmm. The day after the inauguration when they were having all these women acting like idiots. You know, I said, God, what do you say about this? What do you say about this? And he said, when this nation rejected the platform, you know, the Republican platform and the Democratic platform, when they rejected the platform of the Democrats, and that the spirit of Jezebel was broke over this
right.
nation,
yeah.
is what he told me. And again, you have to understand what I'm saying spiritually. I'm not talking about people in particular. I'm talking about a spirit that has captivated a group of
right.
people
right.
and is trying to destroy this nation through the group. Now, the Republicans, pure as white dirt and snow? No. There's issues there too. So I'm not talking parties. I'm talking about an idea.
Yes.
An idea that wants to destroy a nation, that wants to bring it into, you know, a socialistic, godless nation.
Yes.
They want to remove God from this nation. They want to murder babies. They want to, you know, and that spirit got a hold of a group of people
yeah.
and have tried to rule this nation. And again, please don't, I'm trying to be just as gentle as possible. I'm not throwing stones at any one party or anything. I'm just sharing you what God has said to me. And, you know, and God, I believe God's going to turn that party around. I believe that's what he told me. He said he's going to take some of the blue dog Democrats and mostly the southern area, people that love God, that understand the things of God, understand the importance of this United States supporting Israel,
yeah.
backing Israel. He's going to take that group of people and he's going to cause them to come up and recapture that party
Amen.
For what it intended it to be,
Good.
What they intended it to be in the beginning. They've always been the party of the people,
yeah.
the working class people. And God needs that. And so I believe he's going to heal that. He's going to heal both parties because, like Pastor said, you know, this our emblem is the eagle. And the eagle's got to have a left wing and it's got to have a right wing.
Right.
And they've got to be working together to cause that eagle to fly.
Sure.
And that's where God's taking this nation. And that's why I have hope, is because I found out what God says about this nation,
yes.
what the politicians
yes.
or the commentators or the talk shows are saying, or the movie stars, the Hollywood people are saying about this nation.
Yeah.
You know, if they've not been talking with God, they don't have a clue.
That's right.
And when you're spending time with God and say, God, how can I pray for this nation? How can I pray for the Democratic Party? How can I pray for the Republican Party? How can I pray for the Independent? You know, how can I pray for this nation? And what he's told me is that we are one nation under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
Yes.
And that's what I've been praying, unity and a working together. But back to that morning after the inauguration, I said, God, what about these women? You know, they are so clueless and so lost and so,
yeah.
and he told me, he said, pray the virtuous woman scripture out of Proverbs 31 into their lives.
Amen, that's good.
And at the end of that, as I prayed that, at the end of that, I said, I heard myself say, Father, I thank you for the spirit of Elijah that turns the hearts of the mothers to the daughters and the fathers to the sons and restores the family unit again. And that's what God thought about that. And he told me, he said, what you're seeing is a manifestation of that Jezebel spirit letting go of this nation. That was a manifestation. And the Bible says that when the demons left people, sometimes they rent the people and they cried out, they screamed or whatever. And that's what we were seeing that day. The devil was having to leave. He's having to let go. And so as we continue to pray into that momentum, as we begin to, we continue to pray for the church to grow up. Pray the church to be who the church is supposed to be. Quit playing church and be the church. You know, as we pray into the body of Christ, these things, these five things that he gave me, as we pray into them or whatever he gives you, and the body of Christ begins to mature and grow up, and we go from crawling to walking to running to flying, you know, soaring. As we do that, the momentum within, we will see the awakening has already started. This last great awakening has already started. It's in an infant stage, but we've got to reinforce it with our prayers.
Yes.
We've got to reinforce it with our words. We've got to side with God, not what's going on in the world. Amen.